بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. We continue with the devotions of حكيم الأمة شيخ أشرف علي ثانوي رحمه الله. The following essay is taken from the معمولات الأشرفية. Hazrat himself recites in Taraweeh most of the time except in case of dire necessity. He recited 1¼ juz until he reached half the Quran, then one part every day, often finishing by the 27th of Ramadan. One must hear Hazrat's recitation for himself to understand the beauty of his recitation. He recites slowly in tartil and clearly, as is a habit in Taraweeh. If he ever needed to recite faster, it was as though he were reciting slowly, every word being pronounced and clear. Hazrat's way of recitation and pausing between the ayahs is unique and inimitable. His memorization is so good, he rarely stumbles in assimilated ayahs, and it seems as if he is reciting from an open Quran. If anyone asks where such and such an ayah is in the Quran, Hazrat points out immediately and without second thought. When Hazrat was in Kanpur and led Taraweeh there in his early days after graduating from Darul Uloom, the masjid would become so full that unless iftar was eaten quickly and then one rushed to the masjid, it was nearly impossible to find place. Prostrating after reciting the ayah of prostration, Sajdatul Tilawa, was difficult because people sometimes broke their salah. That is, the congregation became confused because people who were far from the imam thought he was bowing when he was prostrating. Hazrat solved this problem by following the second opinion of the Hanafi madhab, in which the bowing immediately after reciting the ayah of prostration. According to this opinion, the necessary prostration can be fulfilled in bowing without having to prostrate. Despite this, Hazrat kept all the rak'ats the same length. It never happened that one rak'ah became longer or shorter than the other because of reciting the ayah of prostration. In Ramadan, Hazrat broke his fast in school, Hazrat's own madrasa, with the guests. The adhan was called exactly at Maghrib time, without rushing. Hazrat opened fast, washed his hands and mouth, and then came to lead the salah. Sufficient time was given between the adhan and salah so that the ablution can be performed without missing the opening takbir. People in the neighborhood also broke their fast at home and attended congregation with the opening takbir. Hazrat completed his Maghrib Salah with the routine awrad and then sat for dinner. For Isha, he stood in the masjid shortly before its time. In Taraweeh, he recited calmly and clearly. Between every four rakat, he read the Sunnah Zikr. His bowing and prostration were the same length as in the average salah. In tahajjud, Hazrat recited loudly and sometimes quietly. If Hazrat was in itikaf and was praying tahajjud, 2 to 4 people came and stood behind him. Though Hazrat never objected to them standing behind him, he also never made a point of praying tahajjud in congregation. In fact, once it happened that Hazrat woke up late, he recited according to his routine in 2 rakats and said, "Perform your sahur, and if you get extra time, then pray tahajjud individually." After tahajjud, he rested until fajr, then woke up for fajr and continued his daily routine for night and day. Sometimes Hazrat performed i'tikaf. His i'tikaf was either the last 10 days or for any 3 days. If and when Hazrat performed i'tikaf, it rained blessings and illuminations, anwar. Hazrat continued his routine of writing during i'tikaf. In fact, he wrote Qasd al-Sabil during i'tikaf in 8 days and another book Al-Futuh fi ma yata'allaqu bir-ruh during the same time. Once I, Muhammad Mustafa, came to the Thana Bhavan on the 28th of Ramadan. I thought Quran was completed since most masjids finished by 27th. I also observed no difference in the look or feel of the masjid or in the ambience of the congregation to assume differently. So I was sure that the Quran had been completed. Coincidentally, Hazrat started Taraweeh with the Surah Al-Duha, which confirmed my feeling that the Quran was completed, since the Imam recited from Surah Al-Duha the day after the Quran was completed in Taraweeh. But when Hazrat recited Bismillah loudly before Surat al-Alaq, I thought maybe he was completing Quran today. I later found that was true. After completion, Hazrat led with dua that was the same as the standard dua. Only one light kept the whole masjid illuminated. No other light was to be seen anywhere in the masjid. That is, usually the masjid are decorated with the colorful lighting on the day of Quran is completed. The number of people was the same as usual, and no sweetmeat was distributed. All indications of Hazrat's simplicity, adherence to the sunnah, and aversion to the innovations. One person requested, Hazrat, I wish to hand out sweetmeat. But Hazrat did not allow him and said, not today, but you can do it tomorrow if you like. Hazrat did not blow for a blessing or henbane seeds or continued reciting from the first few ayahs of Surah Baqarah to Humul Muflihun on the day he finished the Quran. In another place, he writes, Hazrat's daily routine as follows. Hazrat usually wakes up at the midnight and occasionally in 1/6 of the night or little before or after tahajjud. He mostly prayed 8 rakahs, but sometimes more and sometimes less. In Ramadan, he usually recited one part or one juz, but sometimes more in tahajjud. When Hazrat prayed tahajjud, it seemed as if a ray of light like the light of dawn ascended upwards, and a white-colored flame flickered in Hazrat's limb, then rose towards the sky. Hazrat wrote an essay, look in the first volume of Husn al-Aziz in Malfuzat, section of Ramadan, of 1334, July 1916, in which he explains why he changed his mode of dealing with people, being a disciplinarian at first, but later adopting an exhortative style. In this essay he writes, the blessed month of Ramadan came with all its blessing and illuminations. My relations and communications with people in almost completely cut off in the month, especially this year, since I have become extremely sick and have discharged my Juma talks and Taraweel Salat to others. Also, I have not started teaching any new lessons as I did in the previous Ramadan. Neither did I prescribe Zikr or Ashqal to the Murids as I did last year. In this way, this year my Ramadan was truly reclusive, in which I had little contact with anybody. This is why it seemed better to implement this new resolution from the Ramadan. Thus, starting with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I changed my mode of disciplinary to exhortation and ask for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help in this regard. In another place he says, I eat a little less in iftar, so that I may eat fully at the time of Sahur. He also said, I eat extra foods, things like mango, etc. after Taraweeh, so I don't have a difficulty in Salah. Sometimes someone sends mangoes or paluria type of food, and then Ramadan is a month where a variety of dishes are cooked at home. In one hadith it says, it is a month in which the sustenance of a believer is increased. He further writes, I cannot perform any additional worship in Ramadan. The worship pale in my sight, the way stars lose their brilliance when the sun rises. I cannot explain my condition and why I feel this way. The only explanation that comes to mind is that maybe the splendent light of the blessed month of Ramadan pales the brilliance of worship, because of which I do not feel like exerting myself in worship. After listening to the reciter in Taraweeh, Hazrat arrives at home and leads the women folk with 4 rakats in which he recites his own Quran. By the time he finishes, it's about 12 a.m. Then Hazrat wakes again for Sahur at 2:30 a.m. and does not sleep after that. Hazrat takes a long time to fall asleep. Even when he is able to, does not sleep well. Hazrat has suffered from insomnia for a long time. These days, he barely sleeps 2.5 hours. He himself says, I barely sleep. If I wish I could easily keep myself awake the whole night and read something instead, the only thing that stops me from doing so is my base self, my nafs, which then gets the chance to boast of having stayed awake the whole night. When someone asked him, isn't increasing worship in the blessed month of Ramadan against the perpetualness of good deed? Since the blessed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the most beloved deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the consistent one, even if they amount to a little in quantity. Hazrat replied, It is not against perpetuance into increased devotions in Ramadan, because he, the worshipper, never intended to make it perpetual from the very beginning. It is mentioned in the hadith that the Blessed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam increased in the blessed month of Ramadan. Mulvi Hakim Muhammad Yusuf Bijnuri rahimahullah writes in one place, "This year 1337-1919 I stayed in Thanabawan and attended Taraweeh every day of the month of Ramadan." Hazrat himself led the congregation in Taraweeh. He was strict upon the sunnahs, therefore I wish to narrate every aspect of Hazrat Taraweeh for the readers to benefit from and practice upon. In the month of Ramadan, the Azan of Isha was given 1 hour and 40 minutes after the sunset, and the congregation stood 45 minutes later. The recitation was not long in the obligatory Salah. It was mostly surahs like Surah Teen and Surah Fil. In Taraweeh, he recited fluidly and slightly faster than the obligatory Salah, though every word was pronounced and clear, and he was careful to follow the rules of pronunciation, Ikhwa and Izhar. In the beginning, he recited 1.5 juz and then one part or one juz after that until the Quran was completed on the 27th night. Altogether, the obligatory Salah, Taraweeh and Witr took 1.5 hours and sometimes even less. He read the Salat and Salam 25 times in every interval, Taraweeh, between the 4 rakats in slightly raised voice. When I asked Hazrat about it, he replied, "The Sharia does not prescribe anything, so I read what I like and I recite it 25 times so that people get the time to drink water or attend to their need." A short dua is made after Taraweeh, then Witr. If an ayah of the prostration is recited in Taraweeh, sometimes Hazrat would prostrate and sometimes he just went into ruku, that is, he bowed. Hazrat recited Bismillah loudly before the Surah Al-Alaq and recited Surah Ikhlas only once. When someone asked him about this, he replied, "The custom of reciting Surah Al-Ikhlas 3 times is undesirable in the opinion of some scholars and permissible in the opinions of others. Therefore, to consider it desirable is a grave mistake. And the repetition of Surah Ikhlas in Taraweeh is a mere custom." Hazrat also related his opinion on this subject in some detail. One of the things he mentioned is that the hadith says Surah Ikhlas is 1/3 of the Quran. Not that reciting it 3 times gains the reward of the whole Quran. Shah Muhammad Ishaq rahimahullah made a brilliant point about this. He said that the hadith only indicates that a person gets the reward of 1/3 of the Quran, meaning by reciting it 3 times he gets the reward of 3 1/3 of the Quran, and reciting 1/3 of the Quran 3 times does not mean reciting the whole Quran. It is like a person reciting 10 parts or 10 juz 3 times. Nobody is going to call it the recitation of the whole Quran. All praises is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we were able to gain some knowledge of Hazrat Thanvi's devotion from the month of Ramadan. There is a funny incident I would like to add here, which has already been mentioned in Abiti. As contemporaries, Hazrat Thanvi rahimullah and my father had a very open relationship and joked with each other quite often. I remember some of their moments together. Once in Ramadan, my father went as a guest to Hazrat Thanvi. My father asked Hazrat, "What is your routine for iftar?" Hazrat replied, "Once the alarm for iftar rings, I wait for a few minutes for peace of mind." On that day, many more things were prepared for iftar because my father was visiting. My father looked at his watch and then at the sky and began eating, announcing to Hazrat matter-of-factly, "You can wait for your peace of mind." All of my father's helper also put their hands in the food and began to eat. Hazrat Thanvi and his helper sat waiting. After 1 or 2 minutes, Hazrat commented, "By the time I get my peace of mind, there will be nothing left." After Taraweeh, Hazrat asked my father, "What is your routine for Sihr?" My father replied, "I stop eating until I can't tell whether I am fasting or not. That is, I eat to the last minute." My father was exaggerating, otherwise he stopped 3 to 4 minutes before dawn. Hazrat Thanvi said, "I stop 1 hour before dawn." My father said, "You eat in your time, I will eat in mine. I can't fast for 1.5 day. Hazrat Thanvi replied, "No, that's not right. We will eat together. I'll tell you what. You follow my routine for 1 day and be patient with me, and I will do the same the next day for you." It was finally decided that they will start 45 minutes before dawn, eat for 15 to 20 minutes and stop half an hour before dawn. When I had written what I remembered upon this time, the principal of our school, Mazahir al-Ulum, Sheikh Al-Had Muhammad Asadullah, successor of Hazrat Thanvi Rahmullah, sent me a note that he knew some of the answers to the question I sent to Khwaja Azizul Hasan. They are as follows. We shall stop here, inshallah, and then you can go over the questions that were from Khwaja Azizul Hasan Majzoob as well. And when we go over in the next session, we'll go over some of those answers. May Allah give us tawfiq. Subhanallah wa bihamdi. Subhanakallah wa bihamdi. Wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa Jazakallahu khairan for watching or listening to this discourse. Show your appreciation by liking this video to help us bring similar content for you. Also subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so. Clicking the bell icon will notify you of the new discourses which will be uploaded on a regular basis. Most of all, please give us your feedback and du'as in the comments. Please note that we do not use ad revenue or AdSense on YouTube, so check out the campaign link in the description. Jazakallahu khairan.